viewer discretion is advised. The rumors of a giant, fearsome bird terrorizing a remote island reached the Foundation. And it was true, as the scouting party dispatched by the Foundation found out the hard way. When the team arrived, the beast was already terrorizing a local village. The women and children scattered and scrambled for their lives, while the men stayed to hold off the bird with their primitive bows and arrows and makeshift weapons from their fishing gear. "Damn, we gotta get in there and help these people. Team, weapons hot." The team moved in tactical formation, seeking cover while unloading a barrage of lead upon the beast. However, it had no effect on it, only made it angrier. "All right, bring out the big boy. Let's see how it likes this stuff." One of the team members whipped out a rocket launcher and fired at the beast. It merely staggered it. The giant bird let out a loud shriek and retreated. The Foundation couldn't figure out a way to contain the beast. One afternoon, however, a researcher announced himself in front of the meeting. "Gentlemen, I believe I've found the solution to our issue at hand," he said as he lifted up a bowl of cereal and ate a mouthful of it. "Hello everybody, I'm the Rubber. Today, we bring you a SCP Foundation Safe Class Object SCP-1160. SCP-1160, also known as Effective Containment, is a massive, paranatural avian entity located beneath a mountain in an undisclosed island. Despite being roughly 85 meters in height at time of recovery, due to the effectiveness of a peculiar containment method by the Foundation, 1160 has been reduced to a size of roughly 25 centimeters in height. Recovered documents indicated that the entity, referred to as El Ratonero by the original inhabitants of the island, appeared in the year 1765 and began a series of aggressive attacks against the fishing villages of the island. 1160's primary anomalous trait allow it to sustain incredible amounts of damage. It is for all practical purposes considered near indestructible, as the entity is capable of rapidly and fully regenerating lost or damaged tissue and is able to withstand all forms of conventional firearms and artillery. Additionally, 1160 has a number of insect-like eyes around its head and back, providing it with a virtually 360-degree perspective of the area around it. These traits, combined with brute strength and speed, make 1160 particularly deadly in close combat. However, shortly after discovery, the Foundation found out 1160 has one weakness. It is negatively affected by human presence. During the initial discovery of 1160, a team of Foundation scientists hypothesized that the sudden, sharp drop in the entity's aggression was in some way related to the arrival of Foundation personnel on the island. After routine amnestic cycling of D-class subjects assigned to Site 77, which was established on the island, 1160 attacked both the Foundation facility and the nearby fishing villages. During the attack, the entity was noted as being highly aggressive and notably larger, inadvertently resulted in the loss of multiple Foundation personnel and local inhabitants. To properly contain 1160, according to the initial hypothesis, the Foundation put up tourism campaigns and real estate advertisements to attract more tourists and future residents, in order to increase the amount of human presence on the island, which would hopefully result in the suppression of 1160's anomalous traits. However, the plan backfired. As more visitors arrived at the island, the Foundation observed 1160's activities in anticipation. Looking at the beast on the screen, Dr. Strong, the head researcher, felt that perhaps the sudden increase of human presence on the island had started having some impact on its size, as it looked weaker than it initially was. "Yes, it looks like it's reluctant to head out of its nest. Wait a minute." 1160 began to let out an ear-piercingly loud shriek that could be heard on the entire island, startling Dr. Strong in the room. On the island, the locals began to scatter and make preparations to defend against the beast, while the unsuspecting visitors looked confused towards inland. For a moment, it was silence. At the village, the men looked up to the sky. And there it was, the silhouette of the giant buzzard gliding towards them from a distance. "Damn this thing, I thought it would work. We need to send in fire teams to help with the people, now." A heavily armed team was immediately assembled and sent to eliminate 1160. They arrived at the scene. The buildings were crumbling and on fire, bodies everywhere, visitors cradling their loved ones or trembling in fear. It was chaos all around. The fire team immediately whipped out their rocket launchers. "All right, to hell with these pea shooters. It'll only tickle that monster's funny bone. Bring out the big guns, boys. About time it gets a taste of human ingenuity. Fire!" The team fired their rockets all at once and managed to make contact with 1160. "All right, you flying bastard. How do you like the—" Wait, what? When the dust settled, the men could see that the wounds inflicted on the beast were healing themselves rapidly. It took flight, and as it let out a piercing shriek, its wings closed and dived at them. It made an impact so great it created shockwaves that sent the people flying back. The men picked up the injured and retreated immediately. The beast flapped its wings and soared back to the air, letting out a triumphant shriek. The Foundation sustained heavy losses in terms of properties as well as human lives. The campaigns were immediately canceled, and to cover up the incident, the Foundation put the blame on unforeseen natural disasters. "Damn this thing! I swear it was weaker than when we first found it! What changed?" He replayed the footage of the fireteam's effort against 1160 over and over again, hoping to find some clues to its weakness. Just then, the injured captain walked into the room. "Why don't we just, you know, nuke that damn thing?" "Nuke it? Are you insane? That'll kill all of us on the island too." "Sure, let's say we evacuate everyone and drop an atom or whatever on the bird and wipe this island off the map in the process. And if it survives even that, what then? Where do you think it's gonna go next?" The room went silent after the outburst. Dr. Strong returned to the footage and played it again. "I don't know, but I swear, when we were on our way it seemed weaker, especially when people were running and screaming about. But then, as they started dying left and right, damn things started to look revitalized again." What he said stopped Dr. Strong in his track. People dying, revitalized, human presence. "Oh, I think I got it. Captain, call everyone right now. The eggheads, security, marketing, everyone. Oh, and bring me a bowl and some cereal from the pantry if you can find any. Now go!" When everyone had gathered in the room, Dr. Strong strode to the front of the room. "Gentlemen, I believe I've found the solution to our issue at hand. Captain, would you please hand me the cereal? Thank you." His audience looked at him in confusion as he calmly poured out the milk and cereal into the bowl, and then took a mouthful of it. "This is the solution, everyone. We will print the image of 1160 on cereal boxes and distribute them all over the world. We're a cereal company now, boys." His announcement had caused a stir among the people, as expected by the doctor. He continued, "Now I know. This sounds ridiculous. How in the world does selling cereal help contain the beast? Well, you see, the captain told me earlier about how it was regaining its strength when human lives were lost during the encounter. And I've noticed how much weaker it was before it saw the tourists and the team. That led me to one conclusion. Its strength draws from the people's knowledge of its existence. When people were dying, the knowledge of 1160 was left to only a handful of people. That's when 1160 became stronger." The audience murmured with each other. They seemed to be in agreement. The doctor then continued, "This is the perfect long-term solution. Kids love cereal, and the box's presence on the shelf will also help to implant the image of 1160 to the consumer's mind. We'll call this project, Project Saturday Morning." And soon enough, Foundation assets were allocated to the effort, and the project was begun with the intent of spreading awareness of 1160 worldwide. A Foundation front company, Standard Products, released the Super Cocoa Pals breakfast cereal, which were then marketed heavily towards children. The mascot of the brand, affectionately nicknamed as Bradbury Buzzard, was a cartoon caricature resembling 1160. It was featured prominently on the front and back of the box, itself containing some mimetic triggers that were designed to plant specific pieces of information concerning the nature of 1160 and its appearance into the subconscious of the consumers. As human perception of 1160 grew, 1160 began to undergo systemic biological decay and decreased in its size. The project was a success, as the product was a hit, with the surveys returning with positive results, as well as a successful containment of a beast, by keeping it locked in the human minds. Remember to check out my new animation channel, The Rubber Talks, where I share my life story, thoughts, and opinions. Just click on the link in the description to enter the Rubber's world. Before we end this video, we are proud to present these incredibly sweet pieces of fan art. A big thank you to all of you. You can now send us your fan art, and we will be more than happy to show off your best art piece in our next video. Check out our description below on how to submit. I hope you enjoyed today's video. Which SCP do you want to see in the next video, and why it is interesting? Let us know in the comment below. We will draw your story and share it with the world. Don't forget to click like, subscribe to the channel, and hit the bell. Please share it to your friends if you like this video. Thank you so much for watching, and we will see you in the next video. Bye-bye.